Okay, so we laid the foundation with the factors that affect the movement of fashion. So now we're going to talk about the game. The game of fashion, because it's a game. And there's some components, some pieces, and some rules to that game. So we're going to talk about that, and then we're going to wrap up this section of the lecture talking about some theories that influences how fashion is adapted. So here we are. We've gotten the beginnings, right? We have gotten the three major components that predict the movement of fashion. But really, fashion is a game. It is. It is a game. We're all players, whether we want to be or not. And there are some specific components that are used. So there's still, some rules, right? There's some components and rules for this game. So, again, we talked about trend forecasters. Part of what they do, they have a what they do is they help identify the pieces that are going to be most important in a season, and they also define the rules. So, there's a variety of ways of why a variety of theories of why fashion exists and what we wear and what we're attracted to. But really, fashion is the way we express ourselves. It is our outward exhibition of our personality. And, and I hate to say specific and unbeknownst to us, they're kind of behind the scenes, they're covert ways that trend forecasters, designers, and influencers change, actually play and change the game of fashion. So now let's move on to pieces of the game. And, it can be exhausting sometimes, but the pieces of the game just focuses on various parts of the female body. So sometimes it's the waist, or the neckline, or the breasts, or the hips, or the legs, the junk in the trunk. All of those pieces are all of what fashion pays attention to, and they pay attention to it at different points in time. So there is a point in time where the emphasis is all on the waist, right? So if we think of women that wore, literally laced themselves into a corset that moved their organs, because fashion was all about how small your waist was and how your bosom was projected, right? If we think of binding of feet in some ancient cultures, right? So, what that beauty is in fashion, it is a piece that constantly changes. And if we look at these images that we have, right, the image at the bottom, one of those pieces is our body type. And I'm sure all of you can tell me what your body type is. Are you a square, a pear shape, an hourglass, a triangle, an inverted triangle, some iteration of all of these. And how you should dress based on, what your body type is, right? That's a piece of the game, right? Accentuate what your piece is, that's the best, right? And then if we look at the image on the right, we constantly see these images that are often unrealistic. So I feel like she has some Photoshop in there. If this is what Sister Girl looked like, I am go Sister Girl. But we get these images that aren't necessarily realistic for the majority of us. And I am a naturally thin person, and sometimes I see these images and I'm just like, I can't attain that. I can't attain that image on the right, even though I'm a naturally thin person. And then we look at the image at the top, and fashion is finally getting to the point where they recognize that there isn't one standard of beauty, and that women come in lots of shapes and sizes and colors. And being a size larger than a size 12 is not a disadvantage, and that and I don't even say plus size because 12 isn't a plus size, but women bigger than what fashion deems as a standard size, they still want to be sexy and fashionable, and they still have, you know, defined waist and hips, and their curve and their curves should be accentuated as well. So, you know, that's part of the game, right? That's part of that game, and the pieces are what we accentuate. What piece of the anatomy are we going to focus on and spotlight on? And that does shift throughout time. And that shift also helps move fashion forward, hopefully. And it also brings back recurring styles. Since we know part of the game is emphasizing the different pieces of the woman's body, there's still, even in that emphasis, there's still rules. And, you know, one of the biggest rules is that a particular body part is emphasized until it's worn out, and then they move on to something else. So it's exhausted until fashion is ready to move on to another thing. So I have an image of Cardi B here, not shading Cardi. Her body type, her body is her body. But I posted a front shot and not a back shot because right now the emphasis is really, one of the emphasis is on the, you know, big boobs, tiny waist, super boob, you know, the gnunk, the big booty, right? And it'll be that until we get tired of it, and we'll move on to something else. You know, at one point in fashion, it was the super thin, the almost androgynous, the boy-like body, right? So we have these cycles that happen where a particular body type or part of the body is accentuated, and then we move on to something else, and that we swing that pendulum, right? The second part is that, you know, the almost hypocrisy of having some parts covered up and some not. So if we look at the long ball gown we have, so we have a gown that goes all the way to the floor, but has a really plunging neckline, or we have a skirt that's really short with a really high neckline or sleeves, or think about items like a sleeveless turtleneck, right? So a turtleneck should be for cold weather, but it's not. So a sleeveless turtleneck. And even just the ensemble that Cardi has on, that it's a business suit, right? But it's a very, it's a sexy business suit, right? So some of those rules, they can be confusing if you don't understand them. And then the most important rule in fashion is that fashion is always going to move forward. So we should always be looking on the horizon to see what the next fashion trend is going to be. Again, with our in-depth description of what fashion forecasters do, you know, how do we predict the movement of fashion? And if you see what's here on the screen, you got to do 100% of everything, right? So that crystal ball again comes into play. You have to be great at identifying trends and be the early adopter of the trend, or be able to jump on the bandwagon really quickly. So that's where fast fashion comes into play. You have to, you know, have 100% knowledge of your data, right? Data is really important. I used to say when I was a buyer that, you know, people were like, oh, you shop for a living. I'm like, no, I analyze data, right? So understanding your sources of data and always scrubbing it and always looking through data, you know, that predictive analytics data helps you determine what to buy, how much to buy, where to buy, just by looking at what has happened in the past. Now, of course, there's always some one-offs that happen, so of course nobody could ever predicted where we are with COVID, but you know, understanding your sources of data and always scrubbing through it, right? Knowing the importance of timing, having your product hit the right place at the right time for your customer. And what we're going to talk about the next slide over, and then for the rest of the chapter, is just looking at those influential factors and in this technological world that we live in, our influencers are much different than they used to be in the past, and we'll talk about that in just a few minutes here. But really, you know, predicting is 100% of doing all of these things, right? It's 100% of timing. It's 100% of, you know, understanding your data. It's 100% of identifying your trends, and 100% of understanding those influential factors. Our textbook does a great job covering these theories of how FASHM is adopted and moved forward. So I'm going to be a little briefer than I would, because the book does a great job. So make sure that you cover these and understand those the implications that each one has. I'm just going to go over the theories, but in the downward theory is also known as a trickle-down theory. It's also a term that you'll hear in economics, and trickle down is just people at the top of the social structure adopt a FASHM or style, and it trickles down to us. So something is created to haute couture, then it's created for designer ready to wear, and then eventually we get it. That is what FASHM has been like for decades. So, and generally what would happen is once the lower classes, right, once it had gotten down the social structure, the upper classes had moved on to something else. So, you know, the downward theory is essentially what had happened throughout much of recorded FASHM history. Next is the horizontal flow theory, which is newer, and it's also known as the mass market theory. And, you know, the horizontal flow just states that, you know, FASHM moves between groups at similar social levels at the same time. So the upper class adopted in the lower and those on the lower end of the social economic spectrum adopted well. And then the third theory reflects a great social change that we've gone through, and this theory has only been in place for about 60 years. And the upward flow theory just says that young people, and it's specifically young people at lower income levels, often are the most fashionable. They're the FASHM change agents, right? They introduce new culture, and they are more likely to reinterpret FASHM than those at the higher social economic incomes. But what happens is the lower social classes creates it, and then the upward social classes adopts it and then makes it, in my air quotes, fashionable, right? Move the culture. What do we call those? Culture vultures, or, you know, people that, cultural appropriation. Those are some of the terms that we use for that that theory, if we take it out of the context of FASHM. So, you know, as the name implies, it's the exact opposite of the downward flow, that instead of people at the higher social stratification creating FASHM that trickles down, it's going the other way. And you definitely see that movement in streetwear. You actually see it in styling. You see it in the adaptation of luxury brands, how they're reinterpreted at lower social classes, and then oftentimes those same styles are then moved into the luxury realm. I mean, if you know, hopefully you know a little bit about Gucci. If you know anything about Gucci, in the late 80s, early 90s, there was a retailer in Harlem. His name is Dapper Dan, and he was interpreting Gucci logos. He was doing copyright infringement, I'll be clear. He was interpreting Gucci logos and making garments out of the logo when they generally were using them just for bags. And now he is a artist in residence. He's a creative director at Gucci because FASHM has gotten to the point where they see that what was created, you know, on the street has now trickled its way up to the higher end. And we see many streetwear brands like Supreme, you know, that's charging $80 for a t-shirt, right? And it's just an interpretation of what folks at the lower level of the social stratification have done. So that's what we're going to talk about for the rest of this lecture. The next couple of slides, we're going to talk about leaders and influencers and where they used to come from and where they pretty much come from now.